Our scripture reading this morning is 2 Timothy 3, verses 14 through 17. You can follow along on the back of your bulletin if you would like. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have known the sacred writings that are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God and useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work.
Peggy read two scriptures this morning. The first one was from the book of Deuteronomy, which is in the Old Testament, or some people call it the First Testament. It is known as the Shema. The first two words in the passage in Hebrew is Shema Israel. What was really neat is this morning in first service, Loretta Stanky was there, and she's a part of Congregation Beth Israel. And so what I asked, I said, so what does Shema Israel mean? Because typically we translate it as Hear, O Israel. And she said, listen up, people. So, you know, here's somebody who knows Hebrew giving a very good dynamic equivalent translation of what that means. Listen up, people. Talks about the importance of remembering the lessons of faith and scripture day by day throughout your life, whether you are at home, whether you are away, whether you're active, whether you're resting. And it is not just remembering either. It's not just remembering. It's keeping these things close to your heart, like Connor was saying, real close to your heart. Draw on the heart with your hands. No matter where you are, no matter what you do, you can live your faith. Peggy also read 2 Timothy 3, 14 through 17 in the New Testament, which is a similar passage in that Paul is encouraging Timothy to remember the scriptures because they help equip for every good work we do when we are proclaiming the good news of Jesus. So when I read or hear these passages, I'm reminded of how important it is to draw from that deep well of faith, or at least the building blocks of that faith. Now, as most of you know, I didn't grow up in a home that went to church. But for some reason, from the time that I can remember, I have always felt a presence that I know is beyond my comprehension, beyond what my five senses could perceive. Maybe this is what the writer of Ecclesiastes meant by God has made everything beautiful in its time and has also set eternity in the human heart. Maybe that was it. Maybe that was just a piece of eternity in my heart that God said. Something was there. Something was there. I just couldn't put my finger on it. Maybe that was the beginning of my faith journey. I don't know. But I strongly believe that in our journey of faith, we pick things up along our way, and we put them in our faith journey suitcase. Maybe we have two faith journey suitcases. And they're the things that we write on our hearts and that we use later when we need them. Now, one of the things that I wanted to do this summer when I was on sabbatical was take a tour of what I guess I'd call my favorite holy places. And so I spent a lot of my time outdoors because in my lifetime I've discovered a lot of those thin places. The Celts call them thin places, places where the heavenly realm intersects with the earthly realm, places where the presence of God feels closer than usual. And so when I was traveling through Oregon, visiting these thin places up and down the coast and the Cascade Mountains, I found myself traveling through my hometown, Vinita, Oregon, which is about 12 miles west of Eugene, if you're familiar with that part of Oregon. And while I was there, I saw the first church that I ever set foot in, and I snapped a picture. This is Faith Lutheran Church, home of the only preschool kindergarten program in the town of Vinita. They were the only game in town, so if you wanted to go to preschool or kindergarten, that's where you went. Here's where I was actually able to put a name to this presence that I had felt from the very beginning, as far back as I could remember. It was God. And here at Christ Lutheran, every morning when the children would gather together, the teacher would light a candle to remind us of the presence and the light of God. That was such a powerful image for me. It was also the first time that I learned about the Bible. I learned that there was a book all about this God. And so I learned some of the great stories that were contained in the pages of this Bible. I learned about Noah gathering all the animals up. I learned about David and Goliath and Samson and Daniel and Esau and Jacob and so many stories of heroes who did what they did because they had faith in God. That was my takeaway from the Lutherans right there. God was present, and even though we couldn't see God with our eyes, we could use things like candles to remind us of God's presence. And if that wasn't enough, we had the Bible to tell us about the ones who did amazing things because of their faith. And then I thought, well, you know what, if I'm here in Vinita and I'm going to take a picture of the first church I set foot in, I might as well go around and get pictures of all the churches that were important in my faith formation. So I took a road south, I went down Territorial Road, and I took a picture of the Olivet Baptist Church. Now the Olivet Baptist Church, that isn't the building. When I started going there, it was a little white church, one of those little just classic looking white churches. This building was built in the 1970s, and what they did is they took the old white building and they took it up off its foundation and they took it over to another part of the town, and it's a museum now. And unfortunately, the museum was closed on the day that I went through there. But this was the second church I ever set foot in. And I went there because some of the friends that I went to kindergarten with went there. And of course, they invited me to their Christian education program. And so my takeaway from Olivet Baptist Church was the importance of memorizing Scripture. In fact, that's where I learned about the Shema, and I memorized the Shema long before I even knew what Shema meant. And if you have the Word of God committed to memory, you have it written on your heart. And if you have it written on your heart, it's going to be there when you need it. That's what I learned. Here's one of the best things about Olivet Baptist Church. They had a thing called the Bible bus that would come along and pick kids up for Sunday school. It was this old school bus. You know, wheels on the bus go round and round. It was this old school bus, and if you stood out on your driveway, the bus would come and pick you up, and fine and dandy, you'd go to church. But if you waited inside, they'd honk the horn. And the horn was the first seven notes of Jesus Loves Me. It was awesome. Right up there. The neighbors must have hated us for that, but I thought that was the best thing. Olivet Baptist was also the place where I learned faith songs. Not just Jesus Loved Me, but many faith songs. And those have a tendency to live in your heart too, right? And then two blocks from Olivet Baptist Church was Eldora Flick's house. Brought tears to my eyes when I saw that house. In fact, for a while there, I couldn't figure out why this there was a paved parking lot in front of that, and I guess for a while after Eldora died, somebody bought it and made that a quilt shop, and then the people don't own the quilt shop anymore, so it's a house again. But on Friday afternoons, get this, you could leave school 15 minutes early for religious education. Can you, in a public school, because that's the grade school, off to the left there, that's the grade school. And they'd let you out 15 minutes early to go to Eldora Flick's house for religious education. In public school, in Oregon, which is supposedly the most godless state in the 50, you know? But it was the 70s, you know, it was the 70s. And like Olivet Baptist Church, we sang a lot of songs, we memorized a lot of scripture, but what was different here is I felt loved. Eldora was always so happy to see the kids. When we would come to her door, she would just beam and smile and bring us into her house and give us all hugs, and she made these most amazing homemade goodies. We always requested her Rice Krispie Treats because nobody on the earth made Rice Krispie Treats like Eldora Flick. They were awesome. The only thing cooler than Eldora Flick's Friday after school Bible class was her summer vacation Bible school. Not only did we get daily treats, we got to run through the sprinkler for recreation time in the afternoon. That was fun. So what I put into my faith journey suitcase at Eldora Flick's house was that you can get your head wrapped around the love of God much better when it's being taught and demonstrated by someone who genuinely loves you. And so at this point, I'm afraid I took a little detour on my faith journey for several years. And I don't want to get into why, because today is about the positive things that we pick up along the way rather than the negative or scary things. So thankfully, I found Campus Life, which is a parachurch organization that works in cooperation with a number of different churches, and it was a part of Youth for Christ. And I was lucky enough to be attending the high school with the fastest growing campus life program in Lane County. And like Eldora's Bible school, I felt loved and valued. But the biggest thing I took away from campus life is the idea that God is relational and desires to be in relationship with us. And if you want to get to know God, if you want to know the mind and heart of God, look no further than the life and ministry of Jesus. Campus life is where I made my confession of faith. At 9,000 feet elevation at a camp in Montana, a two-week camp in Montana. That's where I decided to follow Jesus. And I think that's where I learned that song. I have decided to follow Jesus. But my campus life leader said I needed to find a church. And I thought, why? Well, because campus life wasn't a church. And I'm like, I've done church before. And Greg said, no, you need to interact with believers of all ages, not just kids your own age and the young adult leaders at campus life. And so I had friends who went to the Bonita Alliance Church. And so I thought I'd give that try. And guess what? This was so cool. That was Eldora Flick's church. And I didn't know that. So I came there and there she was. And guess what? She still loved me. She still loved the kids who were a part of that. She knew everyone's name. She remembered. I was baptized in the Alliance Church, November 18th, 1983. The confession of faith that I made at Campus Life Summer Camp was just one step. The confession of faith in public and with the ritual of burying my old self and arising from the baptismal waters as a new creature in Christ, that was the next step. The Alliance Church was where I learned about the body of Christ with all its
strengths and weaknesses, with all its biceps and black eyes, I learned what it meant to be a part of a church family. So my next church was about 2 miles south of Veneta in Elmira, which is where I went to high school. Veneta didn't have a high school. We went to Elmira for high school. And Open Bible Church was my first charismatic church. No, let me back up. It was the first charismatic church that didn't scare me on the first visit, I guess. I settled down in this church for a couple of years, actually. It's here where I learned how exciting worship can be. I loved the music. And it was played with gusto by this young woman from Jamaica who could really rock the piano and the organ on Sunday morning. And she also jammed on the guitar on Wednesday night and Sunday nights. And yes, go ahead and read into it. That there were some times when I attended church 3 times a week. And I loved it. It was awesome. My next church was Faith Center in Eugene. That was the county's mega church at the time. I actually went there at the same time I was going to the Elmira Open Bible Church, because what I did is I traded my Sunday evening service at the Open Bible Church for the Sunday evening service at Faith Center. And yes, a girl was involved. Guilty as charged. Faith Center had great music too. In fact, what made the Sunday night service so special was oftentimes there was some nationally known gospel group or a Christian band or something like that who would drop by and play. And you know what? As often as I gripe about how I don't like churches that have so many people that you get lost in the crowd, there is something about being in worship with 800 to 1,200 people all singing and praising God at the same time. It reminds you that you are not in this alone, that there are many other people who love Jesus too. This isn't a church, but it's the place where I discovered the church that I'm a part of now. It's at Northwest Christian College, and it's called Northwest Christian University now, right? Mine and I have a little bit of a hard time with that one. There's NCC, because we know the NCC song, and then there's NCU. I don't know the NCU song. Was the music and worship as exciting as the Open Bible and Faith Center? No, not really. In fact, that just about drove me crazy at first. It took me quite a few years to appreciate the, let's call them the classic hymns of the church. But what I took away from the Christian church was how faith and reason were both valid. There was nobody telling me that you couldn't trust science or that it was the devil who planted dinosaur bones all over the earth to sow confusion and unbelief. In fact, this is where I learned that belief and faith were often two entirely different things. And that there's a reason why we call what we're a part of the Christian faith. Because you've got to have faith. It takes faith to follow Jesus. This is where I learned to ask questions about my faith and practice. And those questions were encouraged. This is where I learned to disagree with people over matters of faith and practice without sacrificing the relationship. It's where I learned that you can study the scriptures using every academic discipline out there. It's where I met some of my best friends, including the one I eventually married. It's where I struggled and fought with God over this call to ministry. God won. Most of all, I learned to value and utilize a lot of the things that I had been swirling away in my faith journey suitcase. So, you know, some of you might be new to the faith journey. Some of you have been at it for quite a few years. Some of you have been disciples all your life, disciples of Christ all your life. Some of you have journeyed in and out of different faith traditions throughout your lives. How many people in here are lifelong disciples? Always been disciples. Okay, got quite a few. How many people in here come from or have been a part of different faith traditions? Go ahead and shout some of them out. Wow. Wow. So we represent a lot of different faith traditions. I'm glad you're here today. I'm glad you're all here today. I love the church. And I love this church especially. I hope that as a church, we can bring all of the best things that we have learned along the way to this table. The Lord's Supper is best enjoyed as a potluck. Amen?
Amen.
We all benefit when we get to enjoy the many flavors of the best fixings that we all bring to the table. So may we celebrate unity amidst diversity and do all things in love and charity.